Hello and welcome to this Facebook Live session. And this session is called Science to Climate Action, From Science to Climate Action. And it's part of the research dialogue process where we're really beginning to connect what science is coming out of the work being done here and around the world on climate change with action on the ground. So I'd like to introduce this wonderful panel that I have here today, an all-female panel, and long may that continue. So on my right, our first panelist is Dr. Deborah Roberts. And Dr. Roberts has worked in South Africa for a very long time with the eThekwini municipality. And she has one of those new rare titles called, in 2013, Chief Resilience Officer. So she really understands about resilience in the city context. And so I'll be inviting her to talk more about adaptation planning within the context of cities and how people live and will increasingly live more and more in the future as we go forward. And next to her is a Hindu, Ibrahim, comes from Chad, and she'll be talking to us in terms of the hat that she wears as co-chair of the Indigenous Peoples Forum, one of the panels that she sits on at the UN, looking at how we can bring together traditional knowledge systems and how people have been living for centuries, and all that knowledge which is evolving and entering into the scientific community and helping us to adapt better within our particular context. Next to her is Ryong Lee. Thank you so much for coming. Ryong Kim, I'm sorry. Ryong Kim. And she's head of programs with decision metrics at Climate Kick, and bringing a wealth of knowledge in how we are looking at valuing social goods and in terms of how that value translates to how we then make decisions as to what we invest in, how we change our investments, and how we move towards these resilient futures that we all, you know, want to see. And at the end is Candice Peterson, who comes from the Inuit community, and she'll be sharing some of the work that she's been doing in bridging the gap with the Indigenous community, the Inuit community, and researchers, and looking at how the government is also changing how it works with these communities, and will continue to do so as we move forward into the future. But I'll kick off with Dr. Roberts, because she's on my right here. And I'm going to ask you to just define in your own words what we mean when we say transformative adaptation for resilience. You know, there's a many words, transformative, adaptation, resilience. But I know that in the context of your work, all of that has meaning and in different ways. So perhaps you could give us some examples.
Okay. Thanks, Sheila, and thanks to our viewers and our listeners. You've only introduced half of me, though. So you've introduced the practitioner half. The other half of me works in science, so I'm a co-chair of the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change. And if we look at the work that that scientific body has done, it speaks to us about transformative adaptation being adaptation that allows us to change the fundamental attributes of the socio-ecological systems that make up our civilization. So what does that mean in layperson's language? It really means changing the way we interact with each other as people and how we interact with the natural systems that impact on us. So if you take an example of transformative adaptation from my practitioner half of my life, building green communities in rural poor areas, recreating forests that allow us to adapt to climate change, reduce floods, but also create economies of scale that allow us to lift the poor out of poverty. And so for me, those are the essential elements of transformative adaptation, really allowing us to change the way we do our business and the relationship between people and nature.
That's wonderful. So Hindu, I'd like you to speak a little about Indigenous and local knowledge systems and how they are helping to advance knowledge in terms of adaptation and climate change.
Thank you very much, and thank you for watching. So us coming from the Indigenous communities that where our life is depending from the nature, so our traditional knowledge, it's having the observation of what the nature gives us. For example, in my community, who are the nomadic pastoralists, so we watch always the direction of the wind. We watch the displacement of the birds and also the fruit of the trees. If those fruits are too much this year, it's going to predict the next year. So those watching and and living in harmony with the nature help us to give better information for adaptations. And now we know with the climate change, there is a lack of resources. So for these resources and with our observation of the nature, it help us to make in balance and manage better the shrinking resources and sharing with the communities.
That's wonderful. Thank you. So Ryong, excuse me, I want to invite you to talk about the work that you're doing in helping governments, organizations, and communities to make better decisions based on the evidence that's there, but putting it all within a context to begin to make better decisions for our futures.
Well, I also work in quite a niche topic of finance and how we could actually help investments into sustainability. We all know that investments into sustainability usually require long-term horizons. There are often no returns, especially in terms of adaptation investments. And so one of the key areas that we're kind of focusing on at the moment is how do we encourage investments, how do we get people who actually manage the money to start putting their money behind some of these adaptation investments, sustainability investments, which might not have immediate value. And so this is where we start looking at different notions of value. I mean, we've relied a lot on monetizing the cost of natural resources, and we want to try and branch into essentially what are other notions of value which are just as worthy on the societal level. So these are things like social services that we provide for our children, the childcare that we provide. These are all unvalued within society but play a role and have a role in terms of how we actually move forward. And so this is the niche area that I guess we're looking at.
That's so interesting. I'll come back to you on that. So Candice, tell us how Inuit communities are adapting to climate change. But perhaps you can start by telling us a little bit about Inuit communities in general, because I'm sure a lot of our viewers don't know much about that.
Thank you. So I'm not sure how much you know about Inuit communities, but majority of the communities are actually pretty small. Mm-hmm. Like they can range, the smallest one that we have in my territory is 200 people, and the biggest one we have can go up to 7,000 people. So it's kind of everything in between there. And all the territories are coastal communities. So everyone lives along the coast, so everyone can see the impacts that happen, especially along the coast, like with the ice conditions and everything. And can you repeat your question,
How
please?
Are they adapting to climate change? Yeah. How are they noticing it and how are they adapting to it?
So Inuit actually don't plan to adapt. We just simply adapt. If you think about it, like way back in the day when Inuit were living on the land, and then how when the government came in, and then how we were put into communities, and then how we adapt from using bows and arrows to rifles, and from using dog teams to snowmobiles, and then now we have these apps that I'm currently beta testing that we're kind of using to adapt to the changing. So it's, we don't plan for it, we just simply adapt. And Inuit have always been very good at adapting. That's how we've been thriving for so long. Yeah.
That's really interesting. So you're talking about using apps now to help you actually facilitate that process.
Yeah.
And we're seeing that more and more. We're seeing more new technologies helping us to make decisions and apply those decisions to different contexts. I wonder if you can talk about, if you've seen that in your work, because you do some work in frontier technologies.
Absolutely. So we work a lot with different deep technology applications, artificial intelligence, Internet of Things, big data, distributed ledger technology, which are not necessarily silver bullets in themselves, but they actually help facilitate, and they will help facilitate this, you know, this world that we need to create that is going to be fit for purpose to meet the complex challenges of climate change. So, for example, we have a project which currently tries to put forest conservation onto a digital distributed ledger technology, blockchain, where we can actually then monitor the actual carbon storage within particular trees and help facilitate investments into them. And there you've got a real live transaction, a financial transaction, in return for not necessarily a monetary unit, but some kind of cryptocurrency that represents a ton of CO2. Wow. And so this is where how we can use, you know, this modern day technologies to actually help facilitate how we might want to try and plan for adaptation and resilience, as well as plan for the future.
And how's the uptake on that? People are adapting to using these tools to make their decisions?
Well, this is, you know, it's quite significant for the whole reducing emissions from avoided deforestation, the RED mechanism. because a problem has been, you know, how do you actually make payments to countries? You know, actual payments, they get lost down the value chain, right? And so this is really at the frontier, and so we are piloting it, and hopefully by the end of this year at COP25 in Chile, we would have had a pilot financial transaction that can actually demonstrate an investment into a particular piece of land in Chile.
Wow.
So
I guess now when we start talking about technologies, we begin to think that it's very much more driven by knowledge communities in the West. So I'm really interested that everybody's using apps and everybody's using them to make decisions, and it's helping their lives in different ways. I wonder if you're finding that in your community. Is there more use in technology in everyday life, in how, you know, you live? Has it changed how people live? And particularly women. Are women taking up these technologies, or is it very much a male techie thing?
So, firstly, maybe I can just say technology is a transformative life for all the human being. But we cannot have only technology in one way. We have to put it with the traditional knowledge of indigenous peoples, because as you said, in my communities, the only technology people have is cell phone.
Okay.
So for us, how we can use the cell phone and then transform the informations. So we are developing with the meteorological divisions, the apps, like how we can have the icon to transfer the information about resilience. If the rain is going to come, when it's going to come, if it's going to end with the flood or with the drought, and how the community can use the knowledge and put with the science knowledge together to get adapt. So we are calling co-production of the new knowledge,
yes.
Not having one better app than the others,
yes.
And all at the same level. And going back to the women are very particularly involved on the traditional knowledge. For us, is the one who are transmitting the knowledge from them to the younger generations, and they are conserving the knowledge. And that's why, like, linking them with technology is very important, but hopefully that we will have it in the future. I'm seeing the future is much optimistic,
yeah,
than right now to put all the knowledge together.
Wow. We only have a few minutes left, and the conversation is only just getting interesting, so I'm going to speak a little faster and try and get around a bit faster. So I wanted to ask you about the work you've been doing in South Africa in cities. And we hear a lot about the challenges and climate change that South African cities have had recently, droughts. And how are communities using technology to adapt to that citywide? Because in terms of in Africa, South Africa have more access to these technologies, and it's much more widely used. So how do you find it in your municipality?
So I think an important thing is to call out cities as a unique opportunity for an at-scale intervention. Everyone else has spoken at a community level, but a key element of transformative adaptation and climate resilient development is changing the world at scale. And cities are our largest socio-ecological system currently. So really important to get a handle on the role they can play. But bringing it down to a real life example, you know that the whole eastern area of Africa has been badly hit recently,
yeah,
by floods, which have impacted many people. Certainly, we've been working in an informal settlement where we've used an app as a way to alert people to risk. But unfortunately, the scale of event was so large, and the systems were not able to give a sense of that scale of impact. So the system itself broke down. And I think that's important to realize, is that there will be limits to adaptation. So communities can rally at this level, but without major structural and institutional and financial changes in the bigger system, these localized communities, be they mine formal settlement, Hindus, pastoralists, the Inuit communities, they're all going to be at a disadvantage. And I think that's the power of cities, is can cities band together to effectively take forward adaptation action, which has to be combined with ambitious mitigation action, to effectively change the world. And there I think we see the critical role of city networks in mobilizing that. So it's probably less important to talk for cities at the community level as it is to talk about their macro level impact.
Yeah.
But there they need a seat at the table. They need to be part of the global planning, and that currently is not afforded to them.
But also we have to remember how important it is now in terms of the data we can gather and generate at city level, how actually that can feed up and inform researchers and give us evidence that we were not able to gather in other ways. So cities are going to increasingly be pushing the agenda, I think, on
these things. But a tough one. I mean, it's easy to say that you will have the localized data collection pushing up. Mm. It's very hard to drive general messages from local contextual experiences. And so we need to acknowledge the difficulties in the research environment of making those step changes between the different levels of governance. Great. So again, an important gap for the research community to fill.
Fantastic. Thank you. I think we have to end soon. We've only got 1 minute, but I would like to ask you, Candice, since I think you're probably one of the youngest members of our panels, to tell us about the youth involvement, youth voices. How are young people trying to evolve, holding on to the old and evolving into the new?
So definitely youth are trying to get involved with just everything that's going on. We have a bunch of youth groups that get together, and it's just, I could tell you about one of my experiences. I'm involved in a youth group called Ikapvik, which means bridge, and we're trying to build the bridge, make a bridge between the scientific community and Inuit communities. So in the history, the scientific community hasn't always had the best relationship with Inuit, so we're just trying to bridge that to make a better experience for everybody else. And like these youth-led event groups is what makes things a lot better in the
community. And it's about building trust through dialogue and information sharing. Mm-hmm. That's great. Thank you so much. I think we have to end soon. I'd like to invite you to share more comments and ask our panel members. Information is online, so we can continue this conversation on Facebook. The hashtag is SB50Bonn. So please do continue to engage with us. Thank you so much. I wish we had longer, but I'm sure we'll do this again at some other time. Thank you so much, all of you.
Thank you.